Welcome to the final edition of the SWN podcast for 2022. We're in 2022 now. This is the holiday special. This is a big special episode. I've got a Christmas jumper on and everything. I've got Turbo Man in the background, but I'm full of cold. So that's the winter wonderlandness of this particular show. Joining me for the finale of season 4.5 is the Social Blade. He's got 127,000 followers on YouTube, which is about 126 and a half more than me. He is one half of the new WrestleZone tag team champions. I just saw him wrestle about a couple days ago in this world of timeline, time as a construct and what have you. It is Alex Webb. Welcome back.
Oh, thank you for having me, especially for a big special Christmas finale.
Absolutely. So when I was trying to organize the last few episodes, I knew that just because you're a big nerd like I am, so I knew that a holiday special seemed to be a nice way just to round off the year.
An appropriate way.
Exactly. Especially with like of Guardians holiday special coming out recently, and hopefully it's more that than Star Wars holiday special, but my reputation precedes me with these episodes, so it could be closer to, was it Wookiee Life Day?
Well, we'll aim for it in the middle. We're not going for excellent, but we're not going for Star Wars Christmas special. We'll go for average, and if we exceed that, fantastic.
We'll go for average. That's it. That's the average podcast. That's what I like to do. So last time I spoke to you, it was January, and it would have been just before you made your debut for WrestleZone.
Yes.
I think you were due to make your debut that weekend. I think it was against Ryan Tucker at Summerhill.
Yeah, because I was discussing my tactics of taking his tie and using it in the match.
Which you did, didn't you?
I did, yes. I grabbed it like in the start and threw him out the ring with it, and then I kicked him in the face. Fantastic time, really.
I was so excited to see your rest, because it was like the first time, I think I said at the time, so I won't retread too much ground, but it was the first time I saw you wrestle in WrestleZone. Of course, last time would have been UPW, and that was a long time ago, and I think you had the newsprint tights at that point. So
you said, nice. I'm getting deja vu. I feel like we said the exact same stuff last time.
Quite possibly. So we'll move on to the actual match itself, because it was quite a very special show. The fact that I don't want to belittle your match, but I'm surprised I remembered that anything else that happened after the show, considering what happened in the final closing moments.
My favorite thing about, because Aspen's big return, my favorite thing about that was he came, like, the lights went off, he came in the ring, he had like a towel over his head, and the lights came back up. No one really reacted, they obviously reacted, but like no one like reacted until Lou took off the mask, and I was like, without even seeing his face, it's the most Lou looking human being I've ever seen. Like, everyone should have known that was him.
I think ADM got in my DMs afterwards after I put it up. There's a sentence, ADM in my DMs. He put up going, how did no one know?
I'm like, yeah, exactly.
That's just what you get at WrestleZone. We're here for the ride. We will wait for you to do all the work, and we'll just go, yes, that's how we're supposed to react at this moment.
It was a mental reaction, though, because that was obviously the first show I did that year. And just like hearing everyone go, like, because it was a small crowd as well, because we had COVID restrictions at the time. I say a small crowd, but it was still like a decent amount of people, but fuck me, it was like loud as hell.
I know, the best thing about that video is, obviously, because I'm a big fan of him, you think I would be quite loud, but I was really quite subdued, because that's just what I am. It's my wife screaming. She's screaming, Billy! Billy, it's him! And she does not want me to ever play that video again, because it's all you can hear, and the camera's the other side where she is, so it's the furthest away point.
Did she start showing it when the lights go down?
Because
I swear when the lights go down, I hear someone go, Billy!
Yeah. Quite possibly. Because it was the worst kept secret that it was going to be, he was going to be there, because Kyle can't keep his mouth shut. It was the word. In fact, that you were coming up as well, I was like,
You asked me mid. You asked me mid match. How did I get up there? And I had to quickly be like, early train. That was it.
But did you come out to Hero on that night as well?
No. So Hero was a weird one, because that was the Rumble that I came out for. That.
That was it.
And the only reason I did that was because, beforehand, before going up, I met Aspen at his, because we were getting picked up by DCT. So I was like, I went up to Aspen's. He literally in the 15 minutes that we were waiting to get picked up, he was like, you should come out to Hero. And he made me a quick little entrance video. And then suddenly I'm coming out to Hero. And I'm like, yeah.
I mean, I popped. If nobody else did, I enjoyed it at least.
Thank you, I appreciate that. It just seems so strange. I get the big Spider-Man thing, but for me coming out to no one getting that reference, it seems so strange. Just this man coming out to Hero.
I think I used it. I used an instrument. I had to go scour for an instrumental version I could use on YouTube, so I could do it on our last episode as well.
Yeah, for the first one. Yeah, yeah.
We're spending all that time speaking about Spider-Man. I'm going to have to try and get some sort of Spider-Man reference in there, at least. It was great, though, because I had Patreon at that point, and for the Patreon listeners or viewers, I still had the normal bagpipes, which I found out later this year, later on in the year, everyone hates the bagpipes, so I had to change it.
I didn't mind it.
Back half of the season, everyone I spoke to were going, oh, I hate bagpipes, and I skipped your intro, and I'm like, well, I mean, I'm 150 odd episodes at this point, because someone have told me this by now.
Could have told me by now.
Yeah. So it's now a bit of a boring intro, but, you know, it is what it is. I've got to listen to the people.
But I came out to Hero, and then about 5 minutes into the match, I might have done what Damien did this past show, but I feel like I tweaked my knee or something, because the bit, if you're watching it, I do like, you know, like the Bret Hart stomp where you're like, he puts one foot on the ropes, he jumps up and stomps someone. I was doing that to Ryan Riley, and I must have just landed awkwardly, because you see in the clip me grab my knee and then jump up and down, and I'm like, oh no, because it was very sore. And it's a very obvious, like, I'm hurt, but I don't want people to know. So I'm like, I get in the corner. I'm like, oh no, what do I do? And then the next thing I did was I gave like Nathan North like a big knee and eliminated him. And you see me absolutely crying in the video because my knee is just in agony.
The old Rey Mysterio going on there.
Yes. Oh, my left knee.
Reconstructed. So yeah, that was the start of your year. Mental reaction, and you got to hear about Ryan Tucker's vlog, which
I did.
Still, what, 12 months later, still makes me laugh at the fact that he called it a vlog, and that's what every vlog's called now, a vlog on Vimeo or Dailymotion, wherever he was planned to put it on.
Dailymotion was the one.
So finally, you wrestled in WrestleZone. I'm not going to make this about a WrestleZone podcast. I've got enough to speak about them this week in general, because I still got to write up my thoughts and feelings about Christmas Chaos.
I'm waiting for the review.
I know Adam's got his. I kind of wait for him to write it, so I at least get a jog my memory of what actually happened.
Dude, because his ones are really in-depth, so you read through and just be like, this is what happened.
Yeah, and then you see the difference between me going to a show and me watching a show like on YouTube, because if I go to a show, it's like, this was really good. I don't remember much else.
It's a bit different though, because when you go to a show, you kind of want to experience it. You don't want to be like sitting, like taking notes on your phone or something like that. If you're sitting watching a show though, you can pause, take notes, and then come back to it.
Yeah.
So it's a little bit different.
Yeah, I try not to take as many. Well, I try not to take as many pictures this time, because I think it was Hijinks. Brian was the photographer, was the other side where I was. So every picture I seemed to see was me with my phone out, taking photos of Grado's arse for some reason, because he was like right in front of me.
Oh, fantastic. And
this time I thought, right, he's in front of me, so I won't see it. He won't see me doing this again. And then all the entrance stuff, like the Fatal 4-Way and that, all the stuff that happened next to me, there I am with my phone. Just taking pictures again, and it's ridiculous. I've got like 7 montages in the big Christmas Carnage episode. I don't know how it happened.
Oh, fair enough, though.
Anyway, this isn't about me. This is about, no. I will get back onto Alex. Yeah. So we got that. We got WrestleZone debut. We've got February. You were against the Foundation of the Future Disco as well.
Yeah. Oh God. Yeah. So, yeah, because that was the like raffle show, wasn't it? Because they do, so every year Discovery does a show where it's like the matches are like they're drawn. It's a raffle. The match stipulations are all kind of like a raffle as well. So I think my match was, it was me and Steven wrestling Foundation of Future, but I think my match had like a 316 minute time limit. So that was fantastic.
I love that. I think was it the same show? There was a 1 minute Iron Man match as well. Deacon Matthews and Ryan Richards, maybe.
Oh yeah, it was like it was a. I think I believe it was a. I believe it was like a 10 minute Iron Man match between them.
But it must be fun working disco because it seems to be that they really just not just like using you guys, but they seem to have a bit more freedom when it comes to Discovery Wrestling. Have you found that yourself?
I feel like I think the top two promotions I've enjoyed working for this year. I've always loved going to disco because just the atmosphere is so good, so good there, and you get a good bunch of guys like there, and the atmosphere in the locker room is all nice as well. There's no animosity, no tension, none of that shit. And as everyone gets along, and I've enjoyed like working in front of the crowds and stuff like that because every match I've done, the crowds responded really well to it. And they've given like me, Steven, anyone else that's in the match like great reactions. So I really enjoy working for Disco. And in terms of what we do in the ring, I feel like because it's a crowd that maybe might be a bit more hardcore, if that makes sense, like a bit more hardcore, where we can get away with doing a lot more intricate spots and stuff like that. Because if it's like a family-friendly show, kids are not going to care if you do like a 6 minute standoff backflips. Like I'm going to punch you, and the kids are just like, we want to see slams, and I'm like, that'll be fine then. I really really enjoy working for WrestleZone as well because again the atmosphere is more or less the same. Crowds always seem into it as well. So yeah, I've really enjoyed working for those two promotions in particular this year.
That's it, like you said, with Discovery Wrestling. I have noticed. I mean, I enjoy watching them. I watch them on YouTube and also do write ups and that about them. And you're right in that it is more. It's a bit less story based. It's a bit more athleticism and think you can be a bit more fancy and not so like say at WrestleZone, you could probably spend 5 minutes doing absolutely nothing and folk will still go mental for it. So.
Well, there was a match that I think Aspen was speaking about where he wrestled Tucker, but the only move was at the end, which was lose like granite lariat or whatever.
That's all I heard. It was the one show I missed. Well, other than the Academy shows, it's the one show I missed this year because Jack was born like 2 weeks beforehand, and I was like,
Yeah, of course.
I even though I did check rail times, just the train times, just sneakily, just going, I could probably make it there and back on the train, but I don't think I could have. I don't think I could have gotten away with it. But no, it's the only one I missed this year. And Kyle once again, not content with getting involved in the Rumble match itself. He's now. He had to get involved in that one as well.
I forgot about that.
Pure jealousy on my part, just because I know that if I was trusted with any spot by any wrestler, I would absolutely balls up. I would just screw it up
Is there
entirely.
pushing Aspen back and you pull him back down?
I
I love how he's talking about Aspen quite a lot in this podcast,
know.
and it's only been about 5 minutes.
I know. Well, we'll move on from him. Well, yeah, we'll try and move on from him. But no, yeah, I had nightmares after seeing Kyle do that. But if I did that, I'd probably just grab his leg and went, oh no, the wrong way. I went the wrong way. Anyway, that's my faith. Forget about him. He's
You say that, right? He's probably going to come up when we breach Christmas Chaos because I came out to help him during the main event. So,
yeah, I know. Okay, so we'll try and get a good 20 minutes of no Aspen talk. That's what we'll try and do. So we'll move on to we'll stay on Discovery then. So you were in the tag team tournament. Tail end of last year, you won. Your kind of qualifier, you beat the 9-9, which was a really enjoyable match. I really enjoyed watching it. But then you came up in the quarterfinals against, sorry, semifinals against Kings of the North,
Yes,
which
and then
a little bit
our
different.
dreams went out the window. No. So with that match, I knew it was happening since because they must have beat Stevie Boy and BT at like last disco show before then 2021. So I was aware we were going to meet at one point, and we came up in the tagged show. And when it comes to wrestling, Kings of the North, probably one of my favorite matches this year, just because they're so like insightful with what they're doing. They wrestle fucking everywhere, so like they're really, really good to work with in case of putting a match together, the structure of it, and how everything should work and should look. They seemed really, really happy with it as well. My chest was blistered red afterwards, so that was fun. Yeah, no, the brief mention of that as well. I started off with Bonesaw for obvious
Obviously,
reasons. And as the match started, Bonesaw said, "I'm about to kill the kid from One Direction." And quick-witted as ever, I turned around and was like, "I thought I was getting Bonesaw from Spider-Man. I want a refund." And then he proceeded to, because I think the match started off with us like locking up, doing a little bit of tech, and then into me giving Bonesaw a chop, which was the start of my downfall, really. And then I had to avoid him for a minute, and then he chopped me. And then about 15 chops later, I managed to tag out to Steven. So a great day for me, really.
No, that's it. I think I probably did put in my review as well that I it was not lost on me that you were starting with Bonesaw, because that was just, it had to be,
yes.
Obviously. I mean, notwithstanding your obsession with Spider-Man, just because your name's Alex Webb as well, have me a bit of Bonesaw there. But it's a really physical team, and I like that, like, Damien, of course, I suppose, Damien Corbin is the high flyer out of the two, quote-unquote.
He's like, I suppose you could say like Bonesaw is the more like grounded one of the two, and he's like ground and pound, and Damien's like the big, I don't want to say high flyer, but he's very much like
he's the agile one.
Yeah, we'll say, yeah. We'll say something like that. But we say that, but then if you look at me and Miles, like, you don't say Miles is the high flyer in that team, but he definitely is.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, yeah.
But you know, again, like I really enjoyed working with them, and I feel like the match came together really well as well, and the crowd ate up, so I was happy with it at the end of the day.
And then moving on to, I've got a big gap to July and November, because you were doing things like Bit Reckless as well, and
yeah, right,
Bit of Discovery, but the note that I pointed out was your return to Govan.
Yes, so the last time I was in Govan, it was me and Miles wrestling More Than Hype, and we made the critical mistake. It was supposed to be face. It was Four Swords. It was supposed to be face versus face. That was the way it was laid out to me. We made the critical mistake of letting More Than Hype go out first. So they went out first. They got a big reaction. The crowd loved them. Now, obviously, a lot of them being kids, they then realize we've cheered this team. We're booing the next team that comes out. Didn't help that me and Steven came out in orange.
That was my question. did you remember not to wear orange this
Yes.
Time?
So basically, yes. So after receiving that reaction, and there's a lovely picture of me hugging Steven as the kids flip me off, which is fantastic. I realized that not to come out in orange. So me and Steven wore our black and silver gear with I wear like a pink shirt and Steven wears a blue one. So it was a bit better this time around. We got a lovely, lovely reaction. And then we still lost. So I remember rolling out the ring, saying to Steven, "We really don't do well in Govan, do we?"
I think the CPW, they put up their shows on TikTok or something. So I've yet to actually see them again, because usually the time they have shows on, I'm like, I've got a life between 7 o'clock and night. Well, I say that very loosely. I don't really.
Responsibilities.
That's the better word for it. Responsibilities. and avoiding them during those hours. So I haven't actually seen a CBW show, but yeah, every time someone's wrestling Govan, I just ask about it, because it's just, it always just fascinates me how
Govan's a mental place, just because like the kids are ruthless. Like, kids don't care. They'll say whatever they want to say. Yeah, no, there's definitely been times where I've been like, yeah, the crowds are a bit mental, but I enjoyed my match because I was wrestling Cristiano Brutal. And they're two good lads, so I enjoyed my match. And it was fun because got to play off of them, got to chant baldies at them, and it was all good. Although it's rich coming from me, given the state of my hairline.
See, I was going to mention it, but when I was going through like your YouTube comments for...
It's a community post.
Oh, you got absolutely roasted by quite a lot of people.
Well, that's what happened. I'll always encourage like a bit of like taking the piss out of me, like, because it helps me stay grounded. But with so I posted that on my community posters. For anyone that doesn't know, it's a picture of me holding my YouTube plaque and the WrestleZone tag team belts. And I was like, oh, I've had quite the year, boys. The top comment, and it doesn't help that I pinned it, But the top comment, actually, I'll go quickly read it just so I can give you precisely what it says. Because the top comment is male pattern baldness. with 118 likes, so that's fantastic. The rest of them are quite nice. Like, the rest of them are just like, I've been watching you for 3 years and seeing how far you've come. Like, that type of shit is really nice. But then it's just the odd one that's like, Hulk Hogan is laughing at that hairline. I don't even look that bad. I've just had a match, so of course my hair's a bit sweaty, but yeah, fair enough.
I mean, I obviously can't comment on this because, you know, my went from the center and out. Yours, at least, is going back.
I'm noticing though, like, I did the last Discovery match I did, it was me, Stephen, and Theo wrestling what was supposed to be the full Foundation of Future, but it turned out to be Brad, Ryan, and Ian Skinner. I was watching the match back. You can see on the top of my head, I'm starting to go there as well. It's thinning there too. So it's all going downhill for me, really.
So you're a bandana wrestler going forward then?
No, I'm a wrestler that's probably going to fly to Turkey in the next, like, 6 months. Get a lovely hair transplant.
Make use of all those subscribers and what have you. get the hair plugs in. Yes. I also heard, as well as getting roasted for your unfortunate hairline in that particular picture, you also got roasted a little bit for taking your plaque.
Yes. Well, right. In my mind, I was like, I can take it, and if you want to get like a photo of it, it is cool, or whatever. But I showed up with it, and everyone was just like, "Oh, look at this YouTube prick bringing his plaque, showing off. What a mark for himself!" And I was like, I just want just a little bit extra. I don't know. And then the first thing Aspen comes backstage and is like, because I had like, it was what was with me. I should preference that. I wasn't just take a photo with a plaque for a fiver or something like that, because that's a bit steep. I still thought it was a bit steep to have it as a fiver, but I just, like, everyone else kind of had the similar prices for photos and stuff like that. So I was like, I'll keep it like that, whatever. I put it down there. First thing, Aspen comes back and is like, yeah, I just seen Kyle Watt come up, take a picture of it, and then leave. I was like, where is he? So I believe the first thing I said when I came out during my entrance, I looked at Kyle and was like, pay for the photo. And then I walked around and continued with the rest of my entrance, which was fantastic.
But no, it's a cool thing to see. Even though I was like, yeah, I'm not paying a fiver to get a picture with him.
No,
but,
no, you know, I don't blame you. It was very steep.
I already paid a fiver to get Omar's camise on and probably stretched it out, because he's very he's very lean in comparison to me. I'm just like, I'm like the Hulk wearing it. You had to actually take. You had to put it on and off me, because I couldn't actually, like, move my arms. Really? Once it was on, it was a very sobering moment in my life when I was trying to, because I've got a dodgy arm anyway. It doesn't bend the right way because I broke it years ago, and so I made the mistake of putting my right arm in first. And I know from experience, if I put on a jacket, I have to go left arm first. Yeah. I can actually use my right arm.
Did you go in right arm first? This time?
Right arm first. I was like, oh no, oh no, I can't do this. So I was like, oh, Mark, help me. And then I tried to get it off, and he was like, no, I'm just, like, try to get, you can get your jackets on your action figures and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Wrestling figures.
And you can't
have the sleeveless jackets on. You have to try and get the arms bent back without breaking them. And it wasn't my finest moment.
I'm glad I didn't see it.
I know. I kind of like it with yourself. I kind of hung back and let all, like, the kids and that get their photos first, because I thought is that I could wait, and the kids can't wait. But yeah, I was glad that they kind of all walked away by that point. It was just, although Martin was the one who took the pictures, so I feel like if he could have made fun of me at that point, he probably would have. But thankfully, he might not see me try and get the jacket.
Would have been on Twitter instantly.
Oh, it was awful. It was a great idea at the time, and as soon as I got on, I'm going, nope, I've made a mistake here. But yeah, so we'll speak about that. Get the wrestling stuff out of the way, and then we can speak about other things, because this is what we did last time again. We did about half an hour of wrestling, and then
I would like to think since then there's been a bit more wrestling that I can talk about now, because I've had a few matches Discovery, a few at WrestleZone, a few Reckless, CPW, got the FCW one coming up in, at the time of recording, 5 days, so that's great.
So I think, once again, we're recording just before a match, because I think this is due to go out like a couple of days afterwards, like 12th or something like that. So FCW's
my match,
10th.
Yeah, I have a match for SCW on the 10th. Yeah, it's wrestling Jacob Deacon Wild. And I have played Far Cry 5, so I know exactly how to tackle this man, so it's all good.
Must be cool getting to actually wrestle in Perth. I don't know if you got to do it often or at all at this point.
For Redacted Company, I did it like once or twice, but again, iffy matches at best, and it was kind of like they wouldn't promote it, so there'd be fuck all people would show up. But then for FCW, they actually do a job of promoting their shows, and they get a decent turnout. So I did. I think the first time I wrestled back in Perth for probably about the last like 4 or 5 years was the Rumble for FCW, where I came out, gave Steven a hug, and then I think I super kicked Tom Atlas in the face. So that was a fantastic experience, really.
I mean, I hear it's a really great experience just kicking Tom in the face. I don't know why it just gives off that kind of vibe, but
either kicking, powerbomb, it's just a great experience all around.
or is
I don't
our
powerbomb though.
or is our is our birthday episode was just put him in a fridge. That seemed to be the
just put him
theme.
In the fridge. Fantastic.
I don't know how I felt so bad after that episode because everyone spent 2 hours just absolutely ripping the piss out of Tom, and I felt really bad about it. I thought, am I just promoting bullying here for 2 hours? And then I stopped recording and everyone was nice. And I was like, you've been an arsehole.
It's just for the cameras. All for the cameras.
So yeah, Tom has actually sent a question to Instagram.
Oh, is it? Okay.
Yeah, he asked, who's your favorite PT?
So for anyone that doesn't know, I've had Tom as a PT for since, I think around about May or June. And from my lack of experience with PTs, I love Tom. He's helped me with my diet and stuff like that, and get in considerable better shape than I was at the start of the year. So I hopefully can continue to go down that route, and maybe I'll look significantly better by this time next year when we do Alex Webb episode 4 for the podcast. So all good.
I know. I'm trying to think of a fancy title for it. But well, I mean, this is going to be the holiday special. But I should have really went for the summer. The Spider-Man films don't have any taglines really, except the MCU ones, and I don't think they really fit.
Homecoming, Far From Home, though. Yeah, I don't think they fit. Although you did Into the Webverse for the number 2. If we ever do a number 4, we can do Across the Webverse, because obviously Across the Spider-Verse is coming out. So that there we go. That'll do.
I hate that I called it that, because as soon as I put it up and you put it out, someone commented going, shouldn't it be Into the Spider Web? And I thought, fuck, that is way better.
Everything goes flying off like, oh my god,
I was furious. And if I hadn't actually said it in the episode itself, I would have just went, fuck, I'm changing that, changing it to into the Spider Web.
It's too late now.
I was disgusted with myself as soon as someone said it. So damn you, YouTube, and your comments. You find it weird though that you're getting better shape with the PT and that, so you're gaining muscle but losing hair. You think it's correlating at all?
That is by far it's like such a compliment, but at the same time, it's such like an insult.
I mean, it could be simple. I got fat and I lost my hair, so it could just be a body thing. I don't know.
That's brilliant, by the way. That's so good. If you ever do shorts, that's something you should put out. no, I don't find it weird gaining muscle and losing hair. Because funnily enough, I've been losing hair since I was about 15, so it's become a natural process of life for me now. But again, wait until I go to Turkey and then I'll get it back.
People will be able to notice your hair anyway. If you go to Turkey, you'll get the teeth as well. You know, as well. When in Rome or when in whatever.
I'll get the Roman Reigns look when he first came back, and he had the really jarring white teeth.
Mm-hmm.
Like, because obviously we kind of grown to love it now, but like when Roman Reigns first came back during like the pandemic era, he came back and he obviously had like veneers or something in it, or it was like just porcelain white teeth, and it was so fucking noticeable. And I was like, holy shit! And he put my sunglasses on while he smiles.
Get the old methadone Mick look going. Surprised he didn't whistle when he spoke. Say that. I think if with the state of my teeth, I've fell off my bicycle as a child so many times that mine are like fucked anyway. So if I had the money, I probably would.
My front tooth is, I don't know if I mentioned this before, my front tooth is pretty much, I've only got half of it. The rest is a white filling. Because, oh, see, oh, twins. mine's was a bit, mine, you'd normally think, oh, big, oh, wrestler, I got punched in the face. No, I was a fanny in primary school and got pushed into a wall. Because, right, I should, I'll give context to this. I thought it was like a fun game to like, oh, how am I going to word this? I thought it was a fun game to like, it's like British Bulldogs, but in a way, like you have like a jail, like in my old primary school, it was like an old like Victorian primary school. It was called Caledon Road, and it was like the most old fashioned looking primary school you could possibly imagine. And we had the bit at the back where it was like, just like it wasn't like new or anything like that, like brick walls everywhere, concrete floors, the football pitch was concrete, so you fall on there, you're breaking something. Like, I'm making it sound like a prison, but effectively very old Victorian school, and we had this bit like at the back, which is kind of like a square bit. So I think I had the best idea to be like, oh, we'll put people in there, and that's like the prison, and they have to stay there. And you have to like push him in there or something like that. So I think I was like, I must have been facing the wall, and someone just came up, pushed me, and I like headbutted the wall. And as I came back, I didn't have like half of my front tooth was missing. And that was about 10 years ago, and this filling has still stayed in. So if it falls out anytime soon, I'm blaming this podcast.
Well, mine's not as probably don't try as a home kind of thing. I tried to do a wheelie on my bike, and it came down, the front wheel came down on us, just the only one and only stone in that whole area. It hit that, my face hit the ground. I'd cut my lip, broke my tooth, sharded the other, I've still got like a little chip in the other front tooth. And I sat there, well, it was right outside my house, so I had the bit of tooth in my hand, blood everywhere. And I was going, I don't want to throw it away, can they not put it back on? I was
just get some super glue, just like, here we go, it's fine.
I know, Sabu could do it. But I was like 10 at the time, because I think I could only eat super noodles for about a week before it was so painful.
Yeah.
Because, you know, hitting your face off concrete, that's pretty sad.
Yeah, it's not exactly, not ideal. It's why I let Steven do all the flips so to the outside, because if he falls and hurts himself, it's fine. I'll stay in the ring and do my kicks. That's all I do.
I mean, they're good kicks. So, you know.
Oh, thank you.
Sorry. I feel like I have to compliment you a little bit more when I've just roasted your baldness. When
I was
you
look at
me. And look at me. How's your eyesight? Can I just make fun of that as well? Or
no, I think everything else is fine at the moment. I have a patchy beard if you want to go for that, but
sorry, it's the one thing I've got over you is I've grown a beard.
You ever seen like the beard rollers that people get? I'll just get them and start promoting it. It'll be all good.
I mean, right. So, how have you found the? Because I saw you did that raid as well as your party yeah. promotion. So we'll get back to the wrestling because I want to speak more about Christmas Chaos. But
yeah,
you brought it up, so it seems like a nice segue.
We'll do the sponsorships and then we'll go back to Christmas
yeah,
Chaos.
That's what we'll do. Yeah. So how have you found like last year or so? Because your YouTube has proper. Again, exploded a bit, and you're doing sponsorships for like Raid and that. How weird is it when you have brands contact you going, hey, can you we'll pay you this or give you this, and you get to either.
The thing with that is, it's I work through an agency. This makes it sound a lot more official than what it actually is. Because I got contacted at the start of 2022. I think, or it might have been just before then, it might have been December last year or the start of this year, and by an agency called Algebra Media. And they were like, yo, we have these brands for you. Would you like to take them on for a sponsorship? And they were like, yeah. I was like, and they gave me some figures, and I was like, yes, 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 I'll definitely do that. But again, there was stuff as well when I researched in that, because like you kind of have to do that because you can't promote just shit to people. So like I would go and research them, and I'd look through and just be like, yeah, that's a decent brand that I can promote on my channel and stuff like that, and it also helps fund videos for further down the line. But working with brand stuff like that, it's weird because I'll edit my sponsorships in the same way that I edit my videos, in the sense that it's kind of like a shit post where it's just a lot of memes edited into it. Like, and I'll send the draft to the brand and just fingers crossed they accept it. And 99% of the time they do. But it's so strange to me because the first one I did was like, I think it was for Skillshare. And I just had like Tobey Maguire being like a failing artist needing Skillshare to help him learn Premiere Pro. It's just weird to me that brands are like, yeah, that's fine. We'll let that promote our company.
So it's like it's cool to them because they actually get your channel then if they look at it and go, yeah, okay, that fits in.
Yeah, because typically they'll send me like most brands will send you like a list of requirements, basically. Like anything you're speaking about, they'll send you a list of requirements for what they want you to say. And it'll just be like mention this, mention that. And it's really cool because I can just like, because they let you kind of like do your own, like put your own personal spin on it. I've had ones where they're a bit more strict on how you present the product, which I'm not the biggest fan of. But then again, if they're paying for it, so it's up to them what they want in the advertisement. I enjoy it because it lets me again. I love money, and it lets me fund future videos. So I'm all happy with that. And again, it's weird to me because I never thought YouTube would be this thing where I could just like. I hate calling it a business, but it's starting to become like that for me. It's like becoming my own business, my own brand, and hopefully it keeps on growing that way. But working with sponsors is definitely, it was a weird one to begin with, but now it's kind of more normal because I've done Skillshare, I've done Raid, which was, I feel like everyone, if you become a YouTuber, you have to do Raid. So I was like, yeah, the second I got the offer, I was like, yes, I'm doing Raid Shadow Legends. but yeah, it's decent. And also helps because I've just recently moved house, if you couldn't tell, because I've done 3 podcasts with you and every single podcast has been in a different room. And I've recently, obviously, I'm now... I was staying with my flat with like a flatmate in the first podcast, and I moved back to my mum's because he wanted to move in with his girlfriend. So I got punted, and now I've moved in. I've moved in with my girlfriend. So YouTube is pretty much my full time job and pays my rent. So if I can get like a sponsorship that helps pay my rent, and I don't have to kind of like worry about that, then it gives me a lot more creative freedom with what I want to do, and I can like not stress as much, like having to get a video out like in the next week or so. I can just kind of which. To be fair, Aspen, Steven, Dickie Divers, they all get on at me because I put out one video every 2 months. And it's always got a sponsorship in it. And my work ethic needs to be better. But that's about it.
You can't rush perfection, though.
Exactly. Like, I always say that. It's always about perfection. Come on now.
I mean, because between, like, for you, I don't have that many notifications on YouTube, some wrestling promotions, because if I'm putting, like, their episodes up on the site, then I'll obviously have a notification of that. But outside of that, it's yourself and OSW Review.
I think
that's a pretty good company
I love OSW Review because, which I always got confused because when I started wrestling, you were called OSW TV. Mm-hmm. So I always got confused. I remember speaking to Miles, like literally like 2016, and I was like, yeah, I was watching OSW, and Steven's like, oh yeah, because I think he thought I meant you guys. I was like, yeah, they reviewed like the Royal Rumble where Ric Flair won, and Steven looked at me and was like, that's a peculiar one for them to review, they normally just do Scottish wrestling. I was like, wait, what?
Yeah.
No, I'll take that. That's a very good company to be held up with. Because it was them, a group called New Legacy Inc., and like all the like YouTubers that are like Internet Historian. I don't know if you ever watched someone like that, but like Internet Historian, Pyrocynical as well. People like that kind of inspire me to like make content and stuff like that. The way I edit is more like Internet Historian, but then again, like the kind of retrospectives, I take a lot from OSW and how they structure stuff. Mm-hmm. So thank you. I'll happily take that to be in good company with them.
Yeah, you're not the only one who's had that confusion because when I met Roddy Piper, I had the fucking stupid belt which had OSW on it, and someone came up to me and went, "Oh, I love your videos." I looked at him, was like, "You don't that's me. You, thank you, but it's not who you think it is. I'm sorry." but no, it's that's why I had to rebrand it very quickly. I mean, we both came from the same site. So we both came from old school wrestling. So we're both, that's how the names came from. So,
right, okay.
But yeah, I wish I had the V view count
Yeah, they
must
get
have been really.
like on their wrestling videos, they get mental views. I said like because they're what like near enough 200k subscribers, which is meant to me because I'm like, oh, I can catch up with them soon. But like, yeah, no, it's like they're the way they make stuff is really cool, and I apologize for getting used to mixed up to begin with.
I'm absolutely okay with it. I mean, as long as it's channeling traffic to my site, I really don't care. You can think I'm Irish and all that, but my editing is not as it's nowhere near up to par. I mean, if anything, I don't like editing
I
anyway.
have no clue how Jay manages to like edit those videos as quickly as he does to get them out like super consistently. Like I mind he had like there was a I was watching like the Christmas stuff. It was when they were doing like the whole Lex Luger series, like because they put out a Christmas episode of WrestleMania. Would it be 11 where Brett won the belt?
10 is when he won the belt.
10. Yeah, 10 because 11 was the bad one. So they did one for 10 of that was like the Christmas episode, but they had like five episodes out in the last like 2 months before that. So he must have just been sat at his PC the entire time from November to December. And I credit anyone that can do that because I can't sit at this laptop for longer than like 50 minutes without having to go, I wonder what's on YouTube today. My TV's like, for context, my TV's just like here. So I'm just like, I wonder what's on YouTube today. And then my editing will just be like, oh, wait, I need to do stuff today.
I mean, it's a credit to yourself as well, because I don't know that many kind of Scottish content creators that have got such a big following already, and their videos are always consistent as well. Because I've never played Saints Row, never played them, and yet here I am watching a 20-minute video about why this particular version of Saints Row is the best or worst. I'm like
Thank
going, I'm enjoying this, but it doesn't make me want to buy it. That's the kind of thing.
I
So
think I don't like calling my videos reviews just because like people can review them a lot more eloquently. Exactly. People can review them better than I. They can like script. They can like. There's much better reviews on the Saints Row games than mine, but I feel like my kind of like retrospectives and why I feel the game is bad and the way like I edit it makes them stand out a bit. Like the Saints Row, I did a video on Saints Row 4 last year, and that video just hit 1 million views like a couple months ago, and that's insane to me because that's like 1 million people have said, yeah, I'm gonna watch this. And like if you can watch like one of my videos and you haven't played any of the games, or if I'm gonna start trying to do movies because Morbius is going to come
oh
eventually.
yeah, we're gonna speak about Morbius.
But I'm wanting to do films and stuff like that. Like I'm wanting to do a whole retrospective on like the Spider-Man MTV show with Neil Patrick Harris. But I've like so I've got so many plans for stuff. But I want them to be more like retrospectives and people can like watch it and be like, oh, if you haven't seen it before, maybe it encourages you to go play it. Or if it's a game that I say is bad, you just get some laughs watching it. Like I hope that's how that my videos come across.
So it kind of same kind of vein as a Weekly Planet. They kind of do their caravan of garbage
Yeah,
kind of stuff.
like Caravan of Garbage, but just in maybe a bit more of a structured way. I love Mr. Sunday's videos just because it's two lads sitting down taking the piss and they just like make videos about it. I'm like, you know what, lads, fair fucks to
Yeah, there's so many videos. Again, there's so many ones I listen to when, yeah, I've never seen or maybe not everyone see this, but I've just enjoyed 20 minutes of them just having a
Yeah.
chat about it.
Just literally just what we're doing right now, but they make a lot of money off of it.
Yeah, one day, one day.
One
Although
day.
you were the most viewed episode for most of the year, for
Most of
WrestleZone
the year.
podcast, most of the
Most
year.
of the year.
You're now
Because of
second.
you. To
Angel Hayes.
I'm posting it on the community tab straight away, being like, get me in number one again, boys.
That I mean that's the public one. There is one just above both ears that's on private because I can't put it out anymore
Oh,
because
okay.
for reasons.
Oh, right. Okay. Fair enough.
For anyone who doesn't know, I won't say the name, but if you go back through old episodes, he was baffled by a cheese sandwich. That's all I'm gonna say. That's all I'm gonna say about it. Oh God, I've watched it back recently, 7 minutes, and I cringe because the camera is just like above me. So I was losing my hair at this point when that episode was out. So it's just like a beacon at the top, and I'm just like going. And it was done at the name Redacted show. It was the backstage and a lot, and just in
Yeah, I
one of the
get
changing rooms in the Ardler. And
what you. I think
I
I must have watched K&K podcast when you spoke about your time there.
Yes.
I enjoyed hearing it because I can probably have similar experiences to you, which we will not get into for obvious reasons.
No, but that was so much fun to record because I think I had like 7 beers by the end of it and I was just rambling. I'd given no fucks at that point.
You gave some fantastic insights. I will say that.
it was beautiful and I'll just leave it at that. So people go check that one out. Yeah, so you're second at the moment of the public ones. There is an episode with Kuma that's rattling views at the moment that's catching up with you. And also my ITV celebrity wrestling video.
I've seen that. I thought that was a fantastic video as well. Like for like just venturing into that those type of videos, like genuinely fantastic. I was because normally typically when you like do something new or you do something different, or it's like when you start doing something, like see when I start with YouTube, my first couple of videos were shite. Like my first couple of videos were my very first one, and I still had the message from you saying, oh, can we put this on the site? It was a Young Buck style vlog called Webb's World. Where I went to a name redacted for obvious reasons show, and I had a match, and it's so my ex-girlfriend's in it, and it's so fucking pish. Oh, it's horrid. But yeah, fantastic video, really.
It was so much fun. It was one of those things where I just sat there going, I there's no video like this on YouTube. There's like a 10-minute thing of some clips, but nobody else has done this, so fuck it, I'll do it. Weird.
It's good to see, like, obviously, like when you do like venturing out and doing different stuff, and I really enjoyed that video.
Mm-hmm. Also, I'm doing like the road trip stuff as well, just to kind of mix up a little bit and put out some thoughts and feelings. And usually, it's me after the show in my car in the dark crying. So
I'm very much looking forward to this one. I'm looking forward to the one upcoming, just because obviously the results of Christmas Chaos.
Yes, yeah. Well, let's segue back into that for a moment then. Yes, Christmas Chaos. So you kicked off the main show with the Foundation of the Future, once again being undefeated against them in 2-on-2 tag team competition, and winning the WrestleZone Tag Team Championships with Air Miles. I was shocked. I didn't think that would happen.
You didn't? No.
I mean, I can't predict anything WrestleZone. I don't know why it is. It's like my kryptonite. I predict it never happens. It's just, like, even the main event, I was like, I know what I want. But I sat there going, it's going to be fucking Damien. Damien that wins.
it was a surprise to me as well when I found out about it. And I really enjoy working with Brad and Ryan, and I really enjoyed that match. And I hope it came across well to everyone watching it too. I feel like a lot of people kind of knew your shoes. They didn't expect Foundation to be losing it anytime soon. Like they might have thought Zach was maybe losing the world title, so they thought like potentially Brad and Ryan would probably keep the tag belts to keep them looking good. But nah, me and Miles came in. And we're like, you know what, boys, we're taking those belts from you.
We're just coming in. We're moseying in on the Northeast and just taking all your titles.
Yeah, and we also won with a double roll up, which I feel like has not been seen before.
Yeah, right, okay. So Kyle's got a lot of mentions in this, and he has a vendetta against Dennis Law, particularly, as the referee. But after that, I think it was the new guy. I don't know his name, but it was the new guy that was refereeing that match. And Kyle was furious at the referee involved, because one of you weren't legal. So
yeah, but one of us has the pen anyway.
Yeah, but you got a 5 count to get the other one out. It's just, I'm just saying. So that kind of actually put me more on edge, because like you're saying, if you think Aspen's going to win the main event, then
okay, I get what you mean. Yeah,
the Foundation's going to retain, and when they lost, it was like, oh no, Zach's going to win, or Damon's going to win. It's not going to be my Christmas present. I went to the last like three shows hoping that he was going to win, and he's not going to win. I'm sitting here just going, No. No.
hands and heads, like, come on, boys. We were because after me and Miles won, we, like, backstage was a big TV where everyone can watch the match and stuff like that. And when it came to Aspen's match, the steel cage, I specifically was watching both you and Kyle because I was like, see you coming closer and closer to the edge of your seats, being like, come on, come on.
I know.
I really enjoyed. I really enjoyed like Christmas Chaos because that's like sold out crowd, mental reaction from when me and Stephen picked up the free count as well. And again, I really enjoyed the match, and I hope everyone else enjoyed the match as well. Yeah, and then we came out and took the Foundation of Future out for the main event as well. Or for some reason, I'd said, you know what, Ryan, I'm taking you around the building before I go back around the entranceway.
Yeah, just a nice wee tour of the rest of the place.
Literally, like, I came out, hit him, and I was like, you know what? Took him all the way around to the merch table, hit him. I contemplated grabbing the plaque and hitting him with it, but I was like, you know what? I'll leave it be. And then I took him back around.
Well, it was an amazing moment, and notwithstanding, of course, the actual result at the end. But I seen you guys come out. It's like, wrestling crowds really, they're really just up for just good old stories and wrestling and all that kind of stuff. They're not, like you're saying earlier, they're not that fussed for like the flippity doodles and all the really fancy stuff. They're just like a good body slam and they'll be quite happy. But no, it kind of set you guys like in good standing and as like really big fan favorites when you came out and saved the day and battered. I noticed you went for Ryan though, because I think going after Brad, he looked amped up that whole match. I think I'm glad. Was that kind of conscious thought going, nah, Stephen, you can go for Brad?
Well, if you had noticed in our tag match, I had end up being paired with Brad for the start of the match, where I hit him with a shot, he laughed in my face, and then chopped the soul out of me. So I was like, you know what? I'm not doing this again. So I very much went for Ryan. It wasn't a talk thing. I just let Stephen ran out first and was like, okay, he's with Brad. Come here, Ryan.
I'm going to knock that headband off you. So yeah.
Every match it goes somewhere, and I'm surprised he finds it again.
He must have like just if he eventually turns to the light side of the force, then I'm sure he's got like a stack ready just to sign and
a stack
sell.
To sell. Yeah. Oh, that's a merch making machine there. Yes, definitely.
Absolutely. That, but again, bandanas as well. I'm still surprised that the rejected Vago or Archer haven't put.
You think, yeah, that would be a fantastic idea, just like getting bandanas and stuff like that.
Yeah, I'm sure they'll give you a discount as well. So
I wear caps all the time as well. So I need to get, I like Steven sells, we sell snapbacks. But recently I've been trying to convince Stephen to do beanies and like just normal caps, because I'm like, the more we do, the more money we make, Stephen. You got to think about this from a money-making perspective.
I'm more on board for a beanie. I don't know what it is with snapbacks, but they just make my head look humongous.
There's sometimes like with snapbacks, I like the way I put them on, it just makes me look more bald, so I just don't do it.
Yeah, you've got to really... figure out, you gotta get a little bit of fringe out just to
exactly. Exactly.
I've definitely got hair, guys. I've definitely got hair.
Remember, there was a time when I was meeting Ree in town at one point. She was with a couple of her friends, and I was just when we started like start dating, and I was sitting waiting for her, and then she came out with her friends and left, and then they went down our way, and she came up and said hi, and she was like, "Yeah, one of my friends Daniel said thought you were bald," and I was like, "Fantastic! That does wonders for my self-esteem."
Imagine that we've spent about up to an hour now, and all we've really talked about is some wrestling, Aspen, and your hair situation.
Yes, exactly. Which is pretty much my entire personality rolled into one. Yeah. Apart from now, we have to speak about Venom and Morbius.
Right, okay, we don't have to speak about Let There Be Carnage, because I haven't seen it.
Okay.
So, we can speak about Venom, and we can speak about Morbius. But yeah, after that, I don't obviously Let There Be Carnage yet.
Well,
I think my soul has been broken by Morbius. So,
we'll start with this. I was supposed to, in the middle of the year, make a video called "The Worst Cinematic Universe," and it was going to be me reviewing Venom, Let There Be Carnage, and Morbius, because at the time, Morbius was fucked all over the place because of the Morbin time meme. However, by the time I had finished scripting it, it was kind of dead in the water. And I was like, I'll hold off on this until a later date. Preferably, maybe until like Kraven's coming out, because that's still in the same cinematic universe or whatever. But I have a lot of thoughts on both Venom and Morbius and Let There Be Carnage. However, we're not going to talk about that because it's not that good. Neither is the rest of the film. But I actually quite Venom is like a guilty pleasure for me, mm-hmm. Because I actually like I love the character of Venom. So much. I don't know if you can notice. You won't be because I'm looking at my camera and it's probably about 10 pixels. But I have like a Carnage and a Venom statue up there because the symbiotes to me are some of like my favorite villains in like any Spider-Man media. Especially the symbiote of Venom because obviously attached to Peter first and it's kind of like the duality of him. And it's really cool. It's like a dark version of him. However, you can't do a Venom film without Spider-Man. But apparently you can now. Venom, because Venom, I don't know Venom, where do I start? I like Venom, but there's also stuff where I look at it and I'm like, maybe if this happened this way, it could have been better. And I don't like sitting here saying that, like, oh, if this happened this way, it'd be better, because that implies that I can write it better. And I definitely can't. However, I have ideas. So, Billy, you can title this bit Alex Webb Rewrites Venom.
I'll say my little bit about Venom and then we'll get to it. Yeah, I like Tom Hardy. I like the character of Venom. I thought the film was shit. If you give me Tom Hardy Venom in a better film, I'm all for it.
All right, so Tom Hardy, by the way, it's really refreshing because the film paints like Tom Hardy or Eddie Brock as a complete fucking loser, and it's so refreshing to see that in a film when like The Rock has like in his contract he can't lose a fight in any film. He's got to, even in films he's got to be put over strong, but like with Tom Hardy he just looks like a complete fucking loser and it's so cool. But so see Riot, right, being the main villain,
yeah,
fuck that off. We don't need him as the main villain. We don't, with Gun, oh, because he's so visually boring, just grey. We don't need Riot as a villain. We don't need the whole arc of Riot doing his gap year in Malaysia to come to San Francisco as well. We don't need any of that. Just have, say at the start of the film, we have like, because in like the animated Spider-Man film, animated Spider-Man series even, they had the way the symbiote came was through like a spit, like it's people going to the moon. And the symbiote like attached itself to the space shuttle and caused it to crash like at the Golden Gate Bridge. And that's kind of a cool thing. So do something similar to that and have Eddie Brock, instead of being like a good reporter, he's like a sleazy reporter. And him and Michelle Williams, who didn't really have any chemistry to begin with in the actual film. So keep them apart. Have them be like a strange couple, or maybe just like on the brink of a breakup. Have Eddie Brock be obsessed with like the Life Foundation because he was maybe a reporter there when like the shuttle came down or like destroyed something in San Francisco, and like the Life Foundation, they take like the symbiotes because it's like a big cover up or whatever. And Eddie Brock, he's like trying to figure out what happened there. I don't know, his dog could like. No, I'm not going to say that. I was going to be like, his dog could have got caught in the explosion, but that's a really dark way to start a superhero film. So we're not going to do that. But like, have something like that. So Eddie's like obsessed. Like I'm talking like his full office just covered in like newspaper clippings and stuff like that. And he does the same thing with Carlton Drake. But instead of like his obsession is also like a secret, he does the same thing with Carlton Drake where he confronts him about all the shady shit he's doing. However, instead of doing it just in a corridor randomly at Life Foundation, have it set up that it's like a live interview, like I'm talking like Donald Trump in the White House with like someone questioning him, like style of interview, where it's like he can't like just say turn the cameras off because he's got so many on him. He's got like an audience as well. But Eddie's like just going off script. He's saying this, and when he comes back, people are like, "What the fuck did you do that for?" Like you can't do that. So he gets fired. He loses everything. He's like down on his luck, and then he gets the and then the scientist that comes to him and is like, "Yo, they're doing some shady shit in the Life Foundation." I can't remember her name, but it's a female scientist. Do you remember her?
I blacked out quite a lot of the film, so no.
Okay, so it's a female scientist that comes and like says they're doing some shady shit. They're experimenting on homeless people. We see like let's have a see Carlton Drake experimenting on homeless people as well, and like a bit more body horror stuff because fucking symbiotes and alien goo. We can do that shit. Come on now. I don't know why I'm so passionate about rewriting a Venom film, but here I am. But like, so we have all that happen, and then the scientist is like, "Yo, can you help us out? Because you're obsessed with them; they've ruined your life. So if you can help us out, like expose them or something like that, just show the shady shit they're doing." And then he's like, "You were there when I exposed Carlton Drake on live interview, and he's ruined my life, and you didn't help me, so I'm not going to help you." But if eventually it comes around to it, he comes into the Life Foundation, and then he sees like the Venom symbiote, and he's like, "What the fuck is this thing?" And instead of like him just randomly trying to like burst it open with a fire hydrant, say something happens where like something breaks and it opens up, and then it slowly like attached to Eddie, and then he gets bonded with a symbiote or some shit. I don't know, something like that. But then Carlton Drake finds out that like, why did you do this? Like to the female scientist, and he's like, "Oh, I'm gonna kill you with one of my symbiotes. We're gonna conduct an experiment on you." But instead of having her die like the last people, she bonds with the symbiote and becomes Scream, which is like a big yellow woman symbiote, and it's really cool visually. And then we have like that be like the big fucking final battle of her like taking her vengeance out on Carlton Drake, but then the symbiote corrupts her, and then she like wants to kill everyone. I don't know, but like something like that. And that's how Alex Webb rewrite Venom.
I'm getting vibes of Pepe Silva. That's what I'm getting from that, just with the whole lines in the back. Just I don't know. Have you watched Always Sunny? I don't know why I'm making Always Sunny references. Seems I've only watched like two seasons.
Unfortunately, I haven't. So when you said it about 5 minutes ago, I was like, I'll nod my head and laugh, but I don't actually know what the reference is.
I'll say you'll know the meme of the Pepe Silva meme. You'll know it. I'll send it to you later.
Oh yeah, where he's like looking at the whiteboard, just like.
It's got all the red things on it. He's yes. Got the cigarette, and he's like, Pepe Silva. So, yeah,
I know what you mean now.
There we go. That's fine. Again, I don't know why. My only kind of Always Sunniness is I watched a couple of seasons, didn't like it, and I listened to the podcast, and I enjoy the podcast. So there's that. But you know,
I don't like implying that I can write these films better than actual paid Hollywood writers, because I can. But I just feel like that might be a bit more of a cool way to do a Venom film. I don't know. Just, you know, thoughts out loud.
I mean, like I said, like I enjoyed the character, I enjoyed Tom Hardy, I enjoyed Venom, but I just didn't enjoy the film. It was just, it could have been, like you say, it could be so much better. It could be so much more colorful as well. Like
yeah,
I watched
so
it
dark.
I watched it in my room, and the lights were off, and I could still see fuck all on the TV screen. I had to kind of go check my controller, going brightness up. Brightness, display, movie.
It's just
with nothing.
Those films,
I still can't see anything.
With those films, they're so visually dull as well. Like all three of them, they're just so like they look dead, and there's nothing like to them. So I'm like, why would I like visually? There's nothing going on, so I'll check out a lot of the time. And saying that, still like Venom, but you know, I'm just like I'll like it because it's funny at points and unintentionally funny, especially with. And Wayne getting the symbiote at one point and then coming and making out with Tom Hardy, but it's actually Venom making out with Tom Hardy because they're bros, and only real bros kiss each other.
They're like wiener buddies.
Yes, exactly.
Right. So that's I was a good 10 minutes of just Venom there. Right, we'll get some questions done, and we'll get to Morbius, because there's quite a few questions about Morbius through the Twitter.
Oh, fantastic. Yeah, so, I probably didn't help myself when I tweeted out saying, like, you better not ask about Morbius on this.
I still can't believe I fucking watched it. Right, we've got Adam asking, why is Saints Row better than literally every other franchise?
If he's meaning the reboot, I'm going to have stern words with him, but if not... Saints Row 2 is good, but Saints Row the reboot isn't. I would also maybe argue Red Dead's probably a better franchise than Saints Row.
Okay. We've got Brent Carter. Again, I've never played Saints Row. My old experience with Saints Row is your videos.
Thank you.
Brent Carter asks, oh God, this names I can't even say. Save Shondi or eliminate Killbane?
Yeah. Shondi or Killbane. It's the choice in Saints Row the Third, where you can either save Shondi or kill Killbane. However, I would kill Killbane, because Killbane's like a big Mexican luchador who looks like he looks like the love child of Brock Lesnar and Rey Mysterio, kind of like mixed into one. Just a big roided out man wearing a mask, pretty much.
I was gonna say, when they kind of out of ideas call him Killbane, because that just sounds like Bane.
Yeah, maybe. I honestly don't know. Like, but I would pick to kill Killbane because it's a better ending to the actual game. Because if you save Shondi, you then go and film a movie called Gangsters in Space. I'm not joking. Like, you go from being like at the top of this gang warfare. You save Shondi. Killbane like runs away in his private jet, and then you film, and then you're. And then the next thing you know, you're doing this thing called Gangsters in Space, where you're on a movie set and you're filming a movie where you kill Killbane, in space on Mars, and then the game ends. Legitimately, I am not making this up. That's how the game ends if you pick that ending, which canonically is how the game wants you to pick because that's where it picks up from Saints Row 4. Sorry, what
Everyone,
face that?
my screen did not freeze there. I'm just baffled by that whole explanation of that's
Yeah,
I'm
because
ah.
then in Saints Row 4, you go as a secret special ops agent to go and kill this guy who used to run a company called Stag, which was a military group in Saints Row 3. You go and kill him, and he fires off a nuke that's going to hit the White House. So you jump on this nuke, and then it starts going up, and you like tear it apart, where all the characters are like phoning you, being like, "Oh, it was good to know you, sir. I hope, oh, you're going to die because you're on a nuke going up into space and you're tearing off parts of it." And it's like, "Oh, it's good to know you, sir. Rest in peace." But of course, it's not going to end because then the game would be 5 minutes long and Volition would go bankrupt even quicker. But then you fall off the nuke into the White House and then you're the President of the United States, forgetting the fact you have about several hundred crimes under your belt for the amount of murders you've committed throughout Saints Row 1 to Saints Row 3. And then in Gat Out of Hell, the boss gets sucked into hell, and then as Johnny Gat, you have to go into hell and save him from the devil, and then you kill Satan himself, and then in Saints Row Agents of Mayhem, you have to stop an alien invasion, I'm pretty sure. And then the reboot, your hipsters in Breaking Bad Land.
Now, I know I've been taking some Lemsip today, but I didn't think I took some LSD because I don't know what happened there, but I heard aliens and
See when I see when I see when I oh well yeah, because aliens appear in Saints Row 4, and there's a giant one called Zinyak, who's a giant British alien who destroys planet Earth, and then you're in the Matrix.
course, that's.
I'm not going to elaborate any further on that because I feel like if I continually do that, both our brains are going to melt. So let's just move on.
Okay, yeah, that's okay. Yeah, I'll reset for a moment. I'll reset with Judas Gray's question. He's just put DMG question mark.
I don't know if I'm just really fucking old now because I don't know what he means
Oh,
by
I get to
that.
explain what DMG is to you.
I don't know
Excellent.
what he means by that.
Right. Okay. So this was kind of revealed on his episode of the SW podcast, available. Everyone can go check it out. It's a very interesting watch. DMG. It stands for Dead Mum Gang. And by being part of it, your mum's gotta be dead. You would, I mean, I don't know if you're part of
Pause, pause,
DMG.
pause, pause. Give me a minute, give me a minute, give me a minute. Give me a minute. Fortunately, I was gonna say unfortunately, but I probably should say fortunately. Fortunately, my mum is not passed away. So I am I am not a part of Dead Mum Gang. I could be a part of DGG.
Right, okay.
Dad Gone Gang.
Oh, I thought it'd be dead, just DDG.
No, Dad Gone Gang. Because my dad left. Anyway,
Oh, right, okay. Oh, right, okay. Nice. Oh, right, I'm with you now. Oh, Jesus, awkward. Right, okay.
No, 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 no. I'm not just dropping that on you. I've made many dad jokes in my videos before, so I felt like it was common knowledge that Stephen is my impromptu father because my actual one left. So it's all good.
That DMG thing, that's just, I mean, at least, I mean, our acting reigning king is in DMG. Anyway, right, okay, well, let's move on. I don't know if that's treason. Duke Cannon asking, have you ever made love to the pizza theme from the Spider-Man 2 game?
Well, when I seen that, I got it up on Spotify and went through to read and was like, what did you say about this song? And I started playing it to her and she looked at me and I was like, I love you. Ever think maybe a bit of you know, hokey pokey? And she just then locked me out the room. So, you know, realistically, it was a great time. My supportive wife, all good.
I've yet
But
to
no,
hear
unfortunately, I've never made love to it. I've never. Have you never heard it?
No, I haven't played the Spider-Man
The
2
pizza
game.
theme from Spider-Man 2.
No,
Oh,
unless you've had it again,
I
unless you had
don't
it in one of
know.
your videos, I've probably heard it at some point. It
I
might be
don't
there.
know. I don't know how good the audio quality would be if I played it right now, but maybe look it up and listen to it in your free time or now if
Okay.
you want to. I don't know. But like, it's.
I'll leave that for people to do after the episode. You can all go and go find it yourself.
It's very much like it's not a song you make love to, but it's a song that I will make love to.
Just by yourself.
I'll just have to convince Ree at one point.
Be part of the, I don't know, DHG, Dead
Not
Hand
doing.
Gang.
Okay, we're not
Oh.
doing the acronyms anymore. Let's go on to
No,
next
let's move
question.
on.
Next question.
Let's
Next
move on.
question.
Right, so the last stuff we've got is all Morbius. So
Oh,
we've
fantastic.
got Notorious underscore Reds with Morbius. That's all the words we've got there. And we've got
Great
Ree,
question.
aforementioned Ree.
Yes.
When are you going to finish scripting the Morbius review? So we've kind of
So
already touched on that.
I subjected her to having to watch Morbius. I feel like she's never really forgiven me for since then. Because I sat there and was like, because we'll have times where, like I'll try and take time away from video to actually spend time with her. And because she's super supportive of like all my video stuff and everything. So it's like she's great with it. But obviously, like I'll need to try and take time out from YouTube. Because I feel like everyone has a perception of YouTube where she's like, oh, you make your own hours. But then I'm spending like 6 hours editing nonstop all day. But like with my sleeping pattern as well, like I'm editing at like 5 a.m. But I'll try and obviously make time to spend time with my lovely girlfriend. But I subject her to be like, right, we can I can hit two nails on the head here. We'll spend time together, but we'll also watch Morbius. And then we watch Morbius. And then she was like, looked at me and was like, that is by far the worst thing you've ever made me do. And I was like, you know what, fair enough.
Pizza theme?
just start playing the pizza theme.
Right. Okay. Right. Again, I'll have my before you go on to your rant about it, I'll put in my 2 cents on it. I hated this film. I hated the start, I hated the middle, and I hated, no, I actually enjoyed the end because it was finished. I thought Jared Leto looked like he was subject to speaking out last year in 2020. He looked like a nonce. And I hated him. I hated everything I heard about his actions in this film. I hated his weird Rick and Morty eyes when he was a vampire. I hated the CGI. I hated the weird fucking flowy whatever the fuck it was when he was flying. I hated that he flew just out of nowhere. Didn't seem to learn how to do that. Just was able to do it. I hated this film. And the only reason I watched it is because I knew I was speaking to you. And for a moment, and I like you, Alex. I hated you for a little moment, for because I watched this film with my son. I subjected him to this film. He can't understand. He is 4 months old, and one of his few films he has sat through is Morbius. And
Can I take credit for one of the first films your son's watched being
you can't. You will get the blame for that forever. It was by far the worst film I've ever seen. I went to the cinema to see Bringing Down the House with Queen Latifah and Simon and Steve Martin, and that was pretty high off on the fucking mark. Anyway,
You're gonna hate me. You're gonna hate me when I release a video saying Morbius is underrated. You guys are wrong. No, I don't think I can put it as well as you have just put it there. I can say the film was a calamity of errors from a studio that just wants to make a cinematic universe for the sake of having a cinematic universe. The film didn't do well. They re-released the film when the Morbin time, meme was like cutting about to try and get more money. It cost them more money to re-release the film than what they earned from the re-release. It's a calamity of errors. Like the scripting's awful. The acting is atrocious. Jared Leto did this weird. Jared Leto is the reason method acting has such a horrible reputation right now, because apparently he just cut about in like crutches for like the majority of filming because it got him into Michael Morbius' headspace.
What?
In what way in the film did he act any different from how Jared Leto normally acts? His best friend was Doctor Who, and who he called Milo in the film, but his actual name.
That fucked me off straight away. And that was the first couple of minutes, because I was like, oh, his name was Lauren or whatever.
His name's Lucian.
And then all I heard like for a moment was, there was a previous Milo here. Milo was like, where the fuck did Milo come from?
Right.
So, what happened?
So from what I'm aware, he calls him Milo because the first person he was like friends with in the children's school was called Milo. And Milo died. So he just now kept this name and gave it to other people in the hospital. But they've died. So he gives Lucian this name and then says, the three other people I called Milo, they all died. That's pretty much the implication he's given him. And now they're just best friends, even though the name he has was pretty much given to him because he was going to die.
Right, okay, I'll give one positive, and it's very, very small. I think Matt Smith was okay.
I think the film would have been better if Matt Smith was Morbius.
I would be better if Matt Smith... I think Matt Smith was given a script going, it's a Marvel film, and he thought he was going to be in the MCU.
Yeah.
And he acted as such. He acted like he was in the MCU, but nobody else did.
Everyone's acting like they're in a different film. Yep. The post-credit scene is also mind-bogglingly awful.
Stupid.
I legitimately just watched it like about 15 minutes ago to refresh that. Not 15 minutes, like before this podcast, like 15 minutes before this podcast. Mm-hmm. Just to refresh myself on how awful it is. Because, okay, shit preference. The entirety of the film is not good. The story doesn't make any fucking sense. There's a bit where Morbius is necking on with his love interest, and then you just get Milo like looking on in the distance like a cuck, just sitting there like, you're kissing this person, and he just fucks off, the edgy little man that he is. And then the film ends with her sacrificing herself, and then she comes back as a vampire lady. And then Morbius has the power of bats, but Milo or Lucian has the same powers as Morbius, so surely he should be able to control bats as well. But Morbius controlling bats is treated like this big special power that he has. But what? How did Milo become a vampire man? Because the serum needs to be injected into your spine, because that's how Morbius becomes a big vampire man. Does he just drink it? What happens? Also, Milo shows up and Morbius is like, no, you can't have this. And Milo's like, that's not fair. I want to be normal. And Morbius is like, no, it'll make you a vampire. And instead of Milo being a sensible human being and being like, you know what, that doesn't sound like a good idea, he's like, no, I'm going to... Also, at what point does this crippled man manage to sneak past Morbius to steal a vial of the serum? The whole film is a mind-boggling mess, and I cannot wait to actually start scripting it, this lovely review that I'm eventually going to do.
And the only reason why Morbius worked out that Lucian Milo had taken the serum is because he left one of his fucking crutches behind in the prison cell.
Yeah. I don't know. But the post-credits scene is the worst thing about that film, because it tarnishes the legacy of Vulture. And Homecoming, he's one of the best villains the MCU's done. Mm-hmm. And his whole motivation in that film was he did it for his family. He gets transported into a different universe where his family's not there. And instead of freaking out, he goes, I hope the food's better in this place. And then the next thing we know, he's like meeting up with Morbius. And he says this, in this dead-ass line delivery, he meets up with Morbius, which you can obviously tell was filmed in two different days, because Jared Leto looks like he's acting towards a brick wall. But Adrian Toomes shows up in his big Vulture gear. He sits down and is like, Michael Morbius. I don't know how I ended up here. Must have something to do with Spider-Man. We should team up. That's the context of the conversation. And Michael Morbius sits there and goes, I'm listening. Well then, and then it just ends. Okay.
Right.
Okay.
And with that, how, right, so Vulture's gear in Homecoming is made from Chitauri tech. That's how it's made. So how has he got the same suit? How is he, this film is, there'll be studies made about this film in the future about how could you fuck up something so epically that
I genuinely do not know. I do not know how they managed to, like, I at the very least the film could have been mediocre, but instead it was abhorrently, like I even put a tweet up the first time I seen it and said, just seen Morbius collapse in the theater. Because I did. It was only me, Ryan, and someone else there. So, and Ryan's like, it was like my friend Ryan and like his younger brother. It was the only three people. This was an Odeon cinema. Like, this was like the big fuck off rooms that they have. It was only us three in that room, and we stood up and clapped at the end for the sheer abomination. Like, I genuinely have no clue how they managed to mess up as big as they did. However, I love it for that reason, because it's such a meme now.
Oh, geez, I just...
I'm going to name one of my moves after him.
I'm going to have
a move. Not at the moment. I'll message you eventually, being like, Morbin time is this move, so you can put it in an article or something. I don't know. I've got a Gwen breaker though. That's my favorite one so far.
I've assuming neck breaker of some description. I mean, I'll know
Maguire driver, all good.
If you do it at a show, you just shout it's Morbin time before you do it, then we'll know it's that, and like maybe four people in the crowd will know what it is.
Really, I can't lie to you. If I shout that at a show, my soul will like curl up inside myself and I want to die mid-match. like the amount of like I don't typically get embarrassed that often, but I would get embarrassed shouting it's Morbin time in a wrestling match. I'm talking about like with my taps off, my tits out, but like honestly, no, I would not be able to shout it.
That's your line.
No.
Well, that was a really intense few minutes of. I actually, when I came into this interview, I didn't think I was that passionate about Morbius. Turns out, I was quite passionate about Morbius, and it's. It was an experience. 5 o'clock in the morning, I was sat there watching Morbius, and I'm never going to get that time back. And
2 hours well spent. If honestly, 2 hours well spent.
I will say though, I would watch it again before I watch Eternals.
Yeah, because Eternals are just boring. Morbius is like so bad. It's entertaining.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. Right.
What's a time we've had?
What time? Yeah, I was looking at the time, thinking where.
We both.
How do you go?
We both look defeated right now, Billy.
We do. I think it's a good kind of
like we've had. We both look like we've had a time.
We've had a time. I think that's probably a good time to start wrapping up then, because I was noticing my time now. So I'll let you get
back to your son and actually have a happy time rather than talking about
Morbius. I'll go watch a good film. I'll go watch Jingle All the Way. Before we do that though, what's your future plans then? What have you got in the pipeline? Where wrestling wise, video wise, what's your hopes and dreams?
You can. Being the one half of the WrestleZone Tag Team Champions, suppose you can expect to see me and Miles in WrestleZone from time to time. Maybe defending the belts, probably defending the belts. Who knows? As well as that, hopefully it will be in Discovery. Hopefully we'll get to the finals and potentially win the Reckless Intent Tag Team titles. Just wanting to wrestle all over the place, hopefully get my name out there a bit more as well. As for videos, I have a schedule of videos that I'm wanting to release. Currently, I am back. I'm on my phone just so I'm checking it. Yeah, currently I have a schedule that takes me through to August. Some of the videos on there are the worst zombie game ever made, because I'm wanting to tie that into Dead Island coming out. And it is on the Walking Dead Survivor game with Norman Reedus in it. I have the Guardians of the Galaxy game I'm wanting to do near the time a Guardians of the Galaxy film comes out. I want to do it into the Spider-Verse review near the time Across the Spider-Verse comes out. I'm also wanting to do a long form video on the Spider-Man MTV show. So expect all that in the future.
And is Webb's World coming back?
Absolutely fucking not. not a chance. It's never coming back. Webb's World was, in fairness, it got me into YouTube, but it was a colossal, awful video. It also got copyright claimed by WWE, so that was a great time.
Of all the companies to copyright claim it, at least it wasn't anyone else. Right. Okay. So I'm gonna. That's it. I think that's kind of we've had our intensity of Venom and I forgot the name of the film for a second. It's Morbius.
Morbius.
I'm trying to just get it out of my brain. Is there anything you want to plug before we wrap up then?
I've like obviously find me on YouTube at Alex Webb, Twitter Alex Webb 101, Instagram I think it's the same thing, and subscribe to the SWN podcast because they do good podcasts and good retrospectives, and they do good reviews of every WrestleZone show, so all good.
Excellent, that's fine. And this will be the number one podcast, I'm sure, by Christmas. Right, so have a good one. Let's wrap up there.
You too. Happy holidays, everyone. Hope you enjoyed the holiday special of us ranting about Morbius.